I could send one message to my fellow educators, I love you and appreciate you and I value you. I know what you go through. You are amazing. You are awesome. The things that you do for your children and what you do in the classroom every day, on weekends, during the summer is amazing. Nobody could do the job that you do, that we do.
Welcome, educators, and welcome to all of the supporters and cheerleaders of school teachers, administrators, and staff. Good evening, everyone. I'm Pam Harlan, Director of the Meemic Foundation, and your host for this evening. My dear educators, this is your time to relax as you are about to be embraced with love. Inspirational stories and messages from some of our nation's top education leaders and others in our community. All of us tonight have gathered with the sole purpose to let you know how much we appreciate you and all that you do to educate our youth. Whatever your role is in education, you are important. You are our champion. We want you to know that there are many of us that are cheering for you and praising you each and every day for your dedicated work. This evening is about you, because of you, for you. So from all of us to all of you, we present to you this evening of celebrating educators. Cheers to you.
Hello, my name is Rodney Robinson, and I am the 2019 National Teacher of the Year. I became a teacher to honor my mother. You see, my mother had a very unique journey. She wanted to become a teacher, but due to segregation and poverty growing up in rural Virginia, she was not allowed to get the education to become a teacher. However, she didn't let that stop her. She ran an in-home daycare, taking care of up to 15, 20 children a day, often for little or no pay because she believed in community. And she believed that it was the job of her generation to make things better for the next generation. And growing up in that household, seeing these lessons of equity, love, and community take place every day inspired me. And even when those other children my mother took care of went home, I was very inspired because I had a sister with cerebral palsy. And my mother would often say, "I don't love you any less than your sister, but your sister requires more of my time and attention." And see, that's the lesson of equity. We need to understand that our students come to us on different levels and some require a little more, some require a little less. And so it's really important for us as a teacher to always remember to give our students what they need. The second reason I became an educator was to honor a teacher I had, Mr. Calvin Sorrell. He was my band teacher in 5th through 12th grade. Now keep in mind, you know, I'm not gonna brag, but I was a triple threat. I could play the baritone, trombone, and tuba. But the main reason I took band was because Mr. Sorrell was the only African American male teacher I had in my K through 12 experience. And so I often took, not only did I take band, but I always wanted to be around Mr. Sorrell. Even when I was in high school, Mr. Sorrell coached the girls' softball team. And I would be the manager of the girls' softball team. And I would tell the other students that I was just trying to be around the girls. But the reality was I was around Mr. Sorrell. Because Mr. Sorrell helped me. He taught me just about life and about life as a black man in academia. See, I had my father and my uncles and other black males in my life, but Mr. Sorrell was one of the few guys in my life who had a four-year collegiate degree. And so he always taught me about being myself, about embracing intelligence and how to cope when you're in a world where you're told you're not as smart, you're not as good, or you're different from other Black students because you take a couple of extra honors classes. And so I really honor Mr. Sorrell. And also Mr. Sorrell showed me things. He took me places I had never been. We went to Canada, we went to South Carolina, Florida, places a poor Black kid in rural Virginia would have never gone without him. And so that's another reason why I became a teacher, is I want to be that Mr. Sorrell to my students. I want to be that teacher who helps them with their cultural identity, that teacher who helps them figure out how to attain, how to be better in life, that teacher who shows students the world, the teacher who shows them that you can be whatever you want to be. And that's why I got an education. And I tell you this because education is super hard. Education is harder now than it has ever been. But it's always important to remember your why you got into education. You know, every day I often say, why do I do this? But then I think about those lessons Mr. Sorrell taught me, those lessons my mother taught me of community, and I keep going. And so it's really important to remember your why. And I've been a teacher for 20 years, and I remember in 2015, I kind of hit a breaking point where I was starting to lose my why, and I was becoming burned out. But I decided it was time to switch schools. And so I moved down to Virgie Benford Education Center. Now, Virgie Benford Education Center is a unique school because it's a school inside the Richmond Juvenile Jail. I wanted to learn more about the school-to-prison pipeline, so I decided what better way to learn about the school-to-prison pipeline than to move down into the juvenile jail. And also in 2015, the U.S. Department of Education released a report, and it said that Virginia was the number one state in referring students to juvenile justice system. And so that was my sign. And so Virgie Benford became my school. Now, Virgie Benford has students in grades 6 through 12. Their crimes range from truancy all the way up to murder. But it was important for me to understand and to give these students a second chance. And I often told them a solid education is the best way to take advantage of your second chance. And we had so many great students come through, and we helped so many students because we stayed focused on serving our students. The reality is the education system has problems, a lot of problems. But the best thing you can always remember is that you are there to serve students, not systems. And I'm gonna say that again, serve students, not systems. You know, and it's really important that you always remember that, because sometimes you have to go the extra mile. You have to do the things that may be frowned upon by others. But your job as a teacher, as an educator, is to serve your students well. And so I want to tell you about one of my most inspirational students I had at the detention center, a student by the name of Darren. Now, Darren had an extremely, extremely rough life. Darren was born to a drug-addicted mother who died at a very early age. And he was raised by an older sister and by a foster care system who didn't care about him. He was a misidentified in special education, and so he was constantly in trouble at school. He was in and out of juvenile centers, foster care homes, group homes his entire life. And so he just didn't believe in himself and didn't know who he was. Now, he got convicted of a crime, and he was sentenced to the Richmond Juvenile Jail. And at our jail, he was in our Last Chance program. That is a program for juvenile defenders to get their life together before they move on to serious time. Now, he arrived to us reading on the first grade level, doing math on the second grade level. And so we realized we need to wrap this young man in love before education could take place. And we started to love on him. We started to show him things. We started to work on him. And we got him identified. We got his proper special education diagnosis. We got him into some anger management classes so that he could learn to acknowledge his triggers and control his emotions. And then we gave him intensified reading and math, math instruction. And within a month, he was already on 7th, 8th grade level, whereas he came in on the 1st and 2nd grade level. And also as a part of this Last Chance program, he was able to get a job. And so for the first time in his life, he experienced not only just academic success, but financial success. And he was starting to do really, really well. But as time got close to his release date, he began to get anxious. He began to understand that I know my triggers. And if I'm sent home into a foster care system or to a home environment that doesn't care, I'm only going to end up back in here with more charges. And so what we discovered was a loophole in the Virginia law that said anyone who was 17 years old could get independent living if they had their GED. So we went hard, we went intense to get him to pass all of his GED subjects so that he could get into the independent living. However, when they came up to get released, he was one class short. He needed his math GED. And when he went to court, and what was one of the most heartbreaking things I'd ever seen, he begged the judge to stay in jail because he knew he did not want to go home. And so what we decided as a community was that we were going to get him a group home that actually cared. Even though he was no longer one of our students, we still gave him intensified math tutoring, and he finally passed his GED and got his independent living facility. He worked his job, became a success, and he actually went and joined the U.S. Army. And so I often think about everything that Darren went through, and I say to myself, I can get up. I can do this. You know, because times are hard right now for teachers. Times are hard for educators. And we must always find that inspiration to keep going. And when I think of students like Darren and everything that he went through to just get up, to keep working, to fight against a system that has done everything wrong for him, has not served his needs his entire life, it just makes it much easier for me to get up. It makes it much easier for me to keep going. And so I want you to think about the Darren in your life. Think about the students. Think about the people who inspire you to keep you going every single day, because education is hard. Remember, we are in this because we are in it for, not in it for the hard work, but we're in it for the hard work. And our hard work says that we're here to serve students, not systems. So always remember, serve students, not systems. Thank you.
Hello, everybody. Oh, thank you for being in education. As we look ahead to this great new school year, oh, I want you to just repeat after me. We can do this. We are strong. Our children need us, and they deserve it. So I'm so excited to celebrate you, your dedication, your strength, and coming up back for another great school year. Today, I want you to think about what brings you joy, because we have tough jobs. Wow. So thinking about what brings you joy, I reflected on what brings me joy, and I work in an elementary school. Okay, treats in the lounge. That's always exciting. All right. Another one, sticky hugs from the littles. Mm-hmm. Brings me joy. All right. Here's the nightmare joy, though. Wearing white in the cafeteria on spaghetti day. Nightmare joy, but it's still so fun. Lastly, I would say corny jokes bring me so much joy when the children just make themselves laugh, and I always have a few at the ready. So if you don't know the answer to this one, you'll have to Google it. How do you get a Kleenex to dance? It's a good one. As we think about this school year, I hope you can find moments to find joy. And remember, belonging is super important for all of us, children and adults. Significance, and definitely fun. I hope you find your fun this year. Thank you for being in education. It's going to be a good year.
Hello, I'm Earl Franks, Executive Director of the National Association of Elementary School Principals, NAESP. On behalf of our entire organization, I want to personally thank Michigan educators for your extraordinary leadership during this past year and a half. While our country has been and continues to be flipped upside down from this pandemic, You have demonstrated unbelievable commitment and passion in meeting the educational need for the students you serve. I can't thank you enough for what you have done and continue to do for your students, your school, and your community. From all of us at NAESP, best wishes for a successful school year.
Hey, what's up, guys? My name is Coy Bowles. You might know me as a member of the Zac Brown Band and a musician, or you might also know me as an author of children's books, and also I play children's music. So I'm also an advocate for early education, literacy, and teacher appreciation. So speaking of teacher appreciation, I wanted to give a special shout out from me to you personally to let you know how thankful I am for what you guys do. Being a teacher myself, I teach music and also teach music business class at a university here in Georgia. I just think that teachers are amazing. I've had such a great journey over the last 10 years, getting to meet so many teachers and learning about their stories. And one of the most amazing things that I've got to learn is that you guys do what you do because it's a calling. And that is such a beautiful thing to me. So I've been luckily to have some amazing teachers in my life. And I can honestly say that I wouldn't be sitting here talking in front of you guys right now if it wasn't for a specific person, Mr. Tom Sullivan, my senior year in high school, who pulled me aside out in the hall and wanted to know what I was gonna do for college. And I said, I'm not sure yet. He goes, well, you're a really important person. You have a lot to give, and I wanna make sure you take this next step of your life very seriously. And I went and sat in my car that day, and a light bulb went off, and that he didn't have to believe in me. And if he believed in me, then maybe I should believe in myself even more. And it was kind of the beginning of the end, man. I decided at that point that I was gonna try to be as successful as possible and not take no for an answer when I knew that my creative journey was in front of me. So shout out to Mr. Tom Sullivan, thank you so much. But also thank you guys, because for every one story that I have, you guys have all of these stories of all of these kids that you affect and all these students that you affect. And I want you to know how profound that is. And thank you guys so much for all the craziness that you've weathered over this last year or so. And I know school is about to start back. So I want to wish you guys all the best. Know that you are loved. If you ever need anything, know that I am on your team and I'm here for you. And I just can't thank you guys enough again and again and again for what you do. I think you are the most important thing in our society. And I'm so appreciative for you guys to have embraced me and what I'm creatively trying to do to help. So I love you. I mean it. Shout out to the Meemic Foundation. I wish you guys all the best of luck. I'll see you soon. Peace.
The Meemic Foundation. Clearly, I'm not a music teacher, but hello, everyone. I'm Joe, Mr. D. Dombrowski. I'm a former teacher from the state of Michigan. Wait, former teacher? No, I'm actually still teaching. I don't know why I did that. I'm a former Michigan teacher. That's right. So thank you, Meemic, for having me. Thank you, Meemic Foundation, for having me. I greatly appreciate it and happy to be here today. Education is one of the hardest professions in the world. That is absolutely no doubt. However, usually it's only the educators who understand that. I like to remind educators every single day that we have been in the wildest of times when it comes to the world of education. You know, and all that really matters is that we just keep climbing. We keep climbing to show students that there is light at the end of the tunnel and that everything's going to be okay. And like me, I flopped around districts a little bit, flopped around states. It's okay to switch ladders along the way as long as you just keep climbing. And that's really my message to all teachers. You know, this doesn't stop being difficult, but it also doesn't stop being worth it. Kids every single day need strong, passionate, dedicated educators who are serving students to make the world a better place, because it is students that truly, truly will be making the decisions for us when we can no longer make the decisions for ourselves. So if we are harnessing that energy into our students and making sure that they understand, you know, what it is to be a kind person, what it is to be a member of society, what it is just to be an overall well-rounded, open-minded person, that's truly, truly, truly what matters. When we take a look at what it was like teaching in 2020 and teaching in 2021, there was a lot of things that worked and there was a lot of things that didn't work. At the blink of an eye, we had to reinvent the wheel. We had to teach in a brand new way that had never, ever happened before. The biggest thing that worked is allowing teachers to make the decisions to have autonomy over their own lessons and their own classrooms. Some of the best lessons that I saw happening all over the world were from teachers who were given the flexibility to tap into the community of learners that they were given that school year and work with them in the way that they would best learn. So many times districts give their teachers a curriculum and expect them to teach it with fidelity, almost like a script. But it's actually the teacher's jobs to treat the curriculum as a skeleton and to put the meat on the bones. And what that means is knowing who are the specific kids in our classroom this year and how can we make this curriculum work for them right now. Because the students that we have today are different from the students that we're gonna have next year, are different from the students that we've had 2 years ago. Every single group of learners is so vastly different. So it's up to teachers to be able to make those critical decisions to tap into that specific group, because nobody knows that group of kids more than the teacher themselves. So when we look at how we had to flip to virtual learning overnight, the teachers who took the initiative to create something that worked for them. For example, I was teaching kindergarten at the time, and morning meeting had to be completely restructured for the students to be able to understand the routines and expectations of the classroom. I also am huge on engagement in the classroom. It's what I do. And I needed to stop and think, how can I still make these lessons as hands-on and as engaging as they were when we were teaching in person? What I actually did last year is when I was teaching my kindergartners subtraction, I mailed them home a small bag of dog bones, and they opened them up and they had 5 dog bones, and I would have my dog with me, and I said, you have 5 dog bones, throw 1 to Louie, and they would, and I had someone on the other side throw a dog bone to Louie, and he'd eat it, and they thought Louie was eating their dog bone, and then I say, how many dog bones do you have left? 1, 2, 3, 4, you have 4, and that's how we learned just to subtract in kindergarten last year. But it was because I was able to have autonomy over my own space. And all I want for all educators is to truly have autonomy over their own space to make sure that we are creating the environments that are working for all students. Teaching is one of the most chaotic professions out there. Any teacher will tell you. But what's sad about education is it's not teachers who make the decisions in education. It's people who have never even been in the classroom before. So my message to everyone out there is to be vocal with your struggles, be vocal with your successes, and make sure that everybody around you knows what it means to be a strong, passionate, dedicated teacher. Because it's not easy. And if more people actually knew how not easy it was, the faster we would change this profession for the better. I leave every group of people that I talk to by saying this: change in education is a ripple effect. And change needs to happen. So I encourage every single one of you to be the stone. I'm Joe Dombrowski. I miss you so much, Meemic, and we'll see you on the internet. I love you. Bye.
Hey, this is Dave Burgess with a special message for educators out there. Thank you so much for embracing the mightier purpose of being an educator. You will have a life-changing impact on the students in front of you who will go on and have that impact in their communities, which of course ultimately influences the world. You can't measure a teacher's effectiveness with a standardized test score. Our effectiveness can only be measured through generations, because that's the kind of impact that we have with our students inside of our schools and in our classrooms. So all the way from San Diego, California, thank you so much for everything that you do for kids.
My name is Sherry Dennis, and I'm the 2022 Georgia Teacher of the Year. At the end of last year, my district superintendent gave reflective questions to her Teacher of the Year Council, challenging us to dig deep for answers about our year with COVID. The most striking question: what has been the hardest or most depleting 5% of your professional life? My brutally honest answer: No doubt there were students who gained next to nothing from my hybrid classroom. I knew I was being unfair to myself, but my heart was still heavy, and every other teacher there knew my answer was true because they felt that way too. But I share that story not because pessimism dominated the discussions that followed, rather boundless optimism. Through our experience, we believed in our dedicated, innovative, compassionate colleagues more than ever before, in our students who rose to the monumental academic and emotional challenges, and in the integral role of our schools and communities. So I encourage everyone to step into this year confident in the contributions we have made and will continue to make toward our society's well-being. We have all been stretched, but continue to believe because you are making a difference, changing lives, and making the world a better place. Have a great year.
Hi, I'm Owen Bondono, a ninth grade English teacher at Oak Park High School and the 2021 Michigan Teacher of the Year. My favorite teacher was Miss Finkbeiner, my sixth grade teacher at Montfort Elementary. She had a way of making me feel really special in a way that nobody had really accomplished before, and she was so enthusiastic during her read-alouds. Her love of language was just infectious in the way that she read and the way that she walked us through her thoughts while she was reading. It made me want to be a writer for sure, and it made me want to spread the joy of the things I love to the people around me. I know that teaching can be frustrating and exhausting, and sometimes we don't always get to see where the seeds we plant end up, but thank you so much for being a teacher. I celebrate you today and every day, and I cannot wait to see where all of these seeds we plant end up.
Today, I am talking about stress. Anybody here stressed out? Just go, woohoo! Yeah, I heard you people. I was listening in before we started, and you have no air conditioning. You're teaching outside. Your computers aren't working. Isn't that the truth? I tell you something, you know, getting lucky for a woman is finding a guy to fix her computer. Am I right? Forget about tall, dark, and handsome. I'm looking for a guy who has a big hard drive, a lot of RAM, and knows how to use it. I have a solution to stress, and that is to laugh at it. I'm going to show you today that your life is a joke, and that's the good news. So when stress happens, you can make a humor choice. You can get stressed out and drink, or you can laugh and drink. that's right, Lee. You can drink. Because I have to tell you, I know the stress you're under because I started off as a teacher. I was a teacher for 2 years. And I had to quit because, wow, I couldn't handle all that money and prestige. it doesn't seem to get better. I was teaching, and I was teaching during the day, and I was doing stand-up comedy at night, and it was hard. It was so hard. Sometimes I'd get them confused, and there I would be in homeroom going, hey, everybody, just drink up. Have a good time. Let's get drunk. Oh, God. Being the class clown, not so good when you are a teacher. I don't know. Are you people wearing masks or not wearing masks?
Yes.
Masks.
You have to wear masks. That's good. I did an engagement where people weren't wearing masks. I don't know. I got used to wearing masks. I like wearing masks. You don't have to wear lipstick. And as soon as I took my mask off, what do I hear this guy say to me, smile, you look prettier when you smile, you know, and that's my gynecologist, and you know, that's weird. He's not even looking at my face, right? So I'd like to give you guys a stress test, and just to test what are your levels of stress? So here we go. Ready? Let's check this out. Here are the real top 10 ways you know you're stressed. And this is a scientific test to see if you take your work home. You know you're stressed when number 10, you stay in a bad relationship because you can't handle any staff changes. That's it. I'm staying with my marriage. All right, number nine. When your spouse wants to talk about their emotional needs, you tell them to set up an arc. That's it. Number eight, when you tell your kids scary bedtime stories, they start off with, once upon a time, there was a superintendent who had a new idea. Anybody relate? Oh my God, that's stressful. No, keep those ideas to yourself. Number seven, when your partner gives you a love letter, you score it with a rubric. Oh, we finally got Dora to laugh. Okay. Our game. This laughter is good. When you laugh at a problem, it makes it more manageable. Yeah. Number six, when people ask when you're going to have a kid, you tell them never, because you can't think of a name for a kid without picturing that student in your head. All right, number five, when your kids ask for allowance, you make them fill out a budget request. Come on, do it the right way. Okay. Number four, during confession, you send the priest a link to your corrective action plan. Five. Number three, when you get up at 3 a.m. to go to the bathroom, on the way back to bed, you check to see if you submitted your attendance chart. You know you are stressed. Okay, here we go. All right, number two. When your significant other wants to talk about their emotional needs, you ask them to wait until summer vacation, okay? I'm busy. I'm eating outside with no air conditioning, okay? Wait till summer vacation. All right, here we go. Drum roll. The number one way you know you're stressed. When your partner wants you to try new things in bed, you tell them, sorry, it's not on the course syllabus. So let me hear it. How many of you are stressed? Let's hear a woo-hoo! Oh, it's good to laugh. Laughter improves the immune system and improves everything. So I want to give you, I know you guys, I'm not telling you guys to like quit your job as a teacher and become a stand-up comic, even if you think your life is a joke. But what I want to give you are like three tips on how to lighten up your day, lighten up everybody's day. Okay, here's the first. The first tip is, woohoo, your problem. I want to tell you something. That is not a receding hairline. That is a punchline, okay? Your life is funny, and the things that are wrong with your life are what are funny. You can't joke about other people, but you can joke about yourself. You're not in a miserable marriage. It's comedy material. You don't have the students from hell. They're hecklers. Come on, people. There's nothing you can't joke about. Your son wasn't arrested drunk on the TV show Cops. You have a relative in show business. So let's all try this. This is how we make fun of ourselves. All right. So let me ask you. Let's just say, who wants to try this? Teresa, when someone says hello, how are you? What do you usually say?
Fine, thank you. How about tomorrow? Ask me again tomorrow.
Yeah, okay, fine, thank you, fine. Okay, so you lie, right? You're dealing with so much. So this is a way to lighten up the office. Just say something that's bad and you follow it with this word. It's like, ask me, hello, how are you, Judy? Somebody, Leah, you ask me.
Judy, how are you?
I have muffin top. Woohoo! I have to tell you something. That'll lighten up the workplace by just trying something different, whatever it is. And now, here is my next tip for lightening up. Ready? Ready? Validate your hecklers. You all have hecklers. Usually it's like the people who love you. And, you know, I love you so much, I feel I can really tell, say to you, have you gained any weight? Right? Have you ever had people like, oh, Judy, it looks like you've gained weight. All right, this is what you do. If you go, no, I haven't, da-da-da-da. Well, I'm going on a diet. You're playing their hostile game. Watch what happens when you validate. Oh, you think I've gained weight? I have. Woohoo! Thank you so much for noticing. All that late night snacking has finally paid off. I cured my Woohoo! Try that next time someone says something stupid. Just go. Even if someone calls you the B word, you know, you're right. I'm a B-I-T-C-H. Woo-hoo! I'm a babe in total control of herself. Woo! It works every time. Lightens up. And finally, my last tip is comedy tip number three, appreciate. You know, we all go around trying to catch people doing things wrong, right? What about we catch people doing things right? God, I love the way you take attendance. My God, your Excel charts are fantastic. You know, what does it take? Even a stranger, someone standing next to you at the bank, I love your blue sweater. Looks beautiful. She feels good about herself. She goes home and she hugs her kid. He feels good about himself. Maybe he does his chores and walks the dog. The dog feels good about himself. Maybe he doesn't poop in the living room. Her husband comes home, sees the dog hasn't pooped. He feels good about himself, and he puts the toilet seat down. We can work miracles. Find someone to appreciate, because life doesn't show up fun. It shows up stressful. As soon as you wash your car, it's gonna what?
Ring.
Right. As soon as you're waiting for an important phone call and you put your keys down there, the phone's gonna ring. And there you are, pulling up your pants, popping to get it. You don't have an office. Everybody's looking at you. I wanted to end right now with a song about teachers, a rap song about teachers, and there wasn't one. So I'm going to end with a rap song that I performed for the Kentucky educators, and this is for you.
Education is my vocation, not getting me much appreciation. Always in a crisis situation, no wonder I'm on medication. Say yo. One more form. I need some air. It's not fair. I need some air.
It's not fair. Come
on. Government rules are out of hand. Millions of pages impossible to understand. And what is really deranged? As soon as we learn them, they will change. It's not fair.
It's not fair.
Meetings struggle and grind. When students don't pass the test, it's the teachers who have a cardiac arrest. I just got trained in physical restraint, so now I won't be getting any complaints. Kids, attitudes I can do without, but it's their parents I want to take out. Everyone whines about their pay, but there's coming a judgment day. Unless another bond issue passes, there might not be any classes. Dance break!
My name is Leah Porter, the 21-22 Michigan Teacher of the Year. As educators, we have been through the most unexpected and challenging school year of our careers. The resiliency and flexibility of educators is unlike any other profession. I continue to be in awe of my fellow teachers and their ability to connect and support students even in the most unprecedented times. It seems that as educators, we are touted for our sacrifices. But remember that it is equally important to take care of yourself as well. The teaching community is incredible in the fact that they not only care for and lift students up, but that we also work to lift each other up as well. Lean on your colleagues. You are stronger together. As we embark on this new school year, I know that as a community of educators, we will continue to put students first and advocate for providing the very best education. I salute you and am proud to be a part of this incredible teaching community. I hope you have a wonderful year ahead.
Hello, my name is Justin Johnson and I'm the Illinois 2021 State Teacher of the Year. Last year was arguably one of the most challenging school years in recent history, and many students, teachers, and families are still working to regain some sense of normalcy. I want to take a moment to encourage you as we embark on this new school year in this important work to cultivate young minds and hearts. You have all been resilient, brilliant, and creative in your efforts to quickly shift our normal practices and to recalibrate how we serve our students. It is those same traits that will help us in the coming school year. To all my teachers, specifically to my teachers of color, remember how important you are to the immediate and future success of students and how their dreams can be launched through our ability to see the greatness in each of them. Let us all start each day with the goal of reaching one more student today than I reached yesterday. Good luck this year. Stay safe and mask up.
Hello, my name is Dave Bronick and I'm the principal of Marathon High School. I wanted to take a minute and thank everyone who works in schools helping educate our kids. And I mean everyone, from food service, to maintenance staff, to office staff, teachers' aides, teachers, volunteers. You all mean so much to our kids. The last year and a half of COVID has definitely presented some challenges. And as we move forward into the fall, a few of those challenges may come back up. I just want to encourage everyone to stay focused on the most important thing, making connections with kids. If we all do that, we're going to have a great school year.
Oh, What's up, everybody? I love you teachers. Thank you so much for spending some time with me today. My name is Ron Clark. I'm a fifth and sixth grade teacher. I teach math and history here at RCA. I also do current events for fourth through eighth grade, and I love it. And I'm so excited to be here today because I also love the Meemic Foundation. They do so much for educators. Their goal is to uplift us. And we know our job ain't easy, so we're gonna take all the uplifting we can get. So thank you very much, Meemic Foundation, for believing in us and for seeing all teachers as champions. And I hope you are doing good. I know it's October now. When the first year gets started, we got this energy, we're ready to conquer the world. We're ready to be the champions. Come October, we ain't ready to see these kids no more. It's a rough patch, because your gas runs out. And so I just want to encourage you that if you do feel that way right now, or if you're feeling kind of low, one thing I've learned in life is that whenever you feel lowest, if you take what little bit of energy you do have, if you use it to uplift the people around you, you pull yourself up. But if you put people around you down, you pull yourself down. So it's all about your energy, your spirit, going in there and being in a good mood. I don't know if you know anything about RCA, but we do some wild things. Our lessons are hands-on, it's innovative, it's creative. But some days, I don't got no idea for nothing special. And some nights I want to go to bed. I don't feel like planning nothing really unique. So I go on, go to sleep. But then that next day I tell myself, Ron, since you didn't do anything special for this lesson to bring it to life, to make it exciting, to make it hands-on, you have to be the superpower. You had to be in a good mood, be happy, be energetic. And when the kids walk in, I'd be like, what's up, y'all? Let's go. I'm so glad to see y'all. Y'all are going to have a wonderful day. And I just try to let my energy and my mood be my superpower for that day. But sometimes I don't feel like that. I'll be in the bed and I'll hit the Zoom and I'll hit the snooze. I want to get up. And then finally I'll say to myself, I don't want to teach today. Then I'll think to myself, I don't think I ever want to teach another day in my life. And y'all, my name's on the building. How am I getting out of this? I'm stuck. So I got no choice. So I pull myself up, I go in the shower, I take the Zest soap, and I smear it under my nose. And I don't know if that's healthy, but it'll wake you up. And I'm like, and so then I come into school, and then at 8 a.m., if you ever have eighth graders walk in your classroom, they like them dementors from the Harry Potter book. They'll suck the life out of you, and you'll feel like, But instead of going like that, I fake it. I'm like, what's up, y'all? Come on in, we're gonna have a great day. And I start bouncing, my endorphins get flowing. Then after 10 minutes, I really feel great. I'm like, I wanna have a great day now. And that's important, just your energy, your spirit, even when you feel at your lowest. When I first started working in North Carolina about 26 years ago, I had a rough class and I'd sit in the parking lot and I'd try to talk myself into going into the building. I'd say, Ron, you ain't gonna let these kids see you cry. You're gonna push through, go in there and be happy. Because I told myself the number one characteristic of someone when you work with kids is to be happy. And I'd go in there and I'd smile and I'd say, what's up, y'all? And it worked, because all humans, especially kids, are attracted to good energy, happy energy. It was hard for me though, because the teacher across the hall, we didn't get along. And she was an older teacher and we had different mindsets, and it was difficult to be around her. I'd be walking in the hall and I see her coming, and I'd be in the bathroom, and I did all I could to avoid her. I would wait till her class had been to the bathroom, everyone was out before I'd take my class out, because I didn't want to interact with her, because we were butting heads. And so I would sit in bed at night and I'd think, if she had gone and retired, my life would be perfect. If she'd gone and quit, why don't she quit and move somewhere else? Then I'd have these dream scenarios. I said, well, maybe if her husband divorced her, she'd move back to Raleigh to live with her sister. Look, and shut up. You know you had some dream scenarios about somebody too, somebody you wish were gone. But it's hard to get rid of people sometimes. And so I used to tell myself this. If she would go on and leave, my life would be perfect. Everything else in my life was perfect if she just wouldn't be there. Now when I look back on my life, I realize how ridiculous I was being. I realize that my life was perfect. My life was perfect, y'all. It was awesome. I had so much to be blessed for, but I was choosing to give that individual a lot of power over my happiness. Like, for example, I bet you might work with somebody you don't like, because we're only humans, it's gonna happen. There's probably somebody you don't like in the building, or they rub you the wrong way. And that person is probably having a lot of effect over your emotions, how you feel, things they say to you mean a lot. You are choosing in the movie of your life, which you only get one, you are choosing to cast that person as the villain, and you're giving them a big, huge role. they don't deserve that role in your life. Just like that woman in North Carolina, she didn't deserve that role in my life. I gave it to her and I allowed her to have power over me. And we can't do that, because if you allow somebody like that to make you feel low and to hurt your feelings and to affect you, they're going to steal some of your light. And then when you go home to your family, your children, your spouse, your friends, some of the light that you could have had to share with them, it's been diminished. And they don't deserve that, and you don't deserve that. So therefore, those people that get on your nerves, I view them like salt, like a little piece of salt. They blow in the wind, because that's all the power that I'm going to give them over me. I'll be nice to them. I'll be like, oh, hello, how are you? Have a good day. And they'll walk by, and I'll be like, salt, and I keep on going, because I'm not going to allow that person to have power over me. That is the size of their power. It's just salt. They blow in the wind. Shake them off and focus on why you're blessed. You know, I've been to all 50 states. We've been to countries all over the world. And the reason we did that is because we wanted to see what is going on in education in America and in other countries. And what we found is that there are no perfect schools. Every school we visited had some problem or whatnot, but we learned that some teachers focus on that. And I call them sludge. Well, I can tell you what's wrong here. Well, we got a lot of issues and problems. And these teachers look so negative. But some teachers we found, even in very hard situations, schools have no technology, kids with discipline problems, low income, we found teachers who still chose to be happy. And we learned that it's a mindset. When you look around your school, you can choose to see everything that's wrong with it, and you can allow that to consume you, or you can look around your school and see why you're blessed. Some teachers will say to me, well, I'm at a Title I school. You don't know what I'm dealing with here. And I'll say, oh my goodness, God thought enough of you to put you at a place where you could truly and profoundly make a difference in the lives of kids who really need you. Had you rather be somewhere where kids really don't need you so much? I don't think so. We all want that opportunity to make a difference in the lives of kids. So that's why this year I say, if you're going to teach, teach. If you're going to be here, go for it. Last spring, I was teaching this lesson about probability, and I brought some shaving cream cans, three that were empty, one that was full, and I told the students, I asked a question, I said, if I pick one can, what's the chance I'll pick the one with shaving cream in it? They said 25%. I said, great. I said, what if I mix them up and pick three times in a row? What are the odds I won't pick the one with shaving cream in it? So as we're doing the probability lesson, I told my students, every 10 minutes I'll stop. And if all of you have been focusing for the previous 10 minutes, I'll let you pick one of these cans of shaving cream, and I'll spray it in my face. And if you pick the right one, I'm going to get shaving cream all over me. Kids went crazy, focused, paying attention. My fifth graders tried to get it five times. Not once did they get it. So, like, the probability didn't work. But then with my seventh grade class, the very first time they picked, shaving cream all over me. So the probability didn't work with them either. But we learned a lesson. We learned that with more data, probability would be more accurate. And then I was just had my class divided up for my current events lesson for geography. Had a trash can here, a trash can there. I told the kids at the end of each 10 minutes, the side that's trying the hardest can ball up a sheet of paper and try to make it in the trash can. And then the class will see which trash can is the most full, and that side wins. Just something silly. You know, it's just about doing something. If you're going to be here. And like I said, some days I don't have anything special to do. So I say, I'll just be in a good mood, a really good mood today. That'll be my gift to my students. I was teaching persuasive language in the spring, and I was asking the students, you know, what types of words do people use when they're trying to persuade you? Unlimited time only. Got to hurry up. Buy one, get one free. Oh, you're getting something free. In persuasive language, they use the word you a lot. Like the Uncle Sam poster, I want you. So we were talking about all the different ways that people persuade you to do things. And then I asked the students, have you ever seen a toy on a commercial and you really had to have that toy because you saw the commercial and it was so great? They're like, yes. I said, but then you get the toy and it didn't even give what it was supposed to give. They're like, yes, I got a toy and it wasn't what I thought it was going to be. I said, but how did that company persuade you to think you had to have it right then? You would have given anything for that toy. How do they do that? How do they trick you? Well, in the middle of the lesson, Ajahnay Smith, a member of our staff, brings in this big present that's elaborately wrapped. And I was like, what's going on, Ms. Smith? She said, your mother just sent this. It just arrived. And she said it's for the fifth graders, and that since they couldn't go to her house because of the COVID, she wants them to open it now, and it's a big surprise for them. And the kids were like, oh, what? I said, oh, I know what this is. Since we couldn't go to Mom's house, she wanted to bake y'all cookies and candies and send toys. That's why she sent this present. And Ms. Smith said, and she wants y'all to open it right now. The kids like, yes. I said, nuh-uh. We got some learning to do. We got class time. You ain't gonna waste my class time opening this present because you'll spend the rest of my class eating cookies and brownies. We're gonna put the present up here. Come see me at the end of the day. We'll open it then. And they're like, yes, sir. And I was like, crap, because I thought they were gonna push back against me a little bit. But when they didn't, I said, or maybe I could let the sixth graders open the present. They're like, no. I said, no, hear me out. My sixth graders, they're a great group. I bet if I told them they could open the present and miss class time, I bet they would promise me to do double homework to make up for it. We'll do double homework. We promise. I said, y'all wouldn't do double homework. They said, yes, we would. I said, you all promise? They said, yes, sir, please let us open it. I said, okay, go ahead. And they ripped open the present, and you can probably guess what was inside. It was the doubled homework assignment. And they were like, why would your mom send this? And I was like, my mom didn't send it. I wrapped the present. But how did I persuade you to think you had to have it? And what types of persuasive techniques did I use to make you feel like you had to open it right then? And so it turned into a really cool lesson. So when I think back to this spring, some lessons stand out to me. I can remember Dante going, why would your mom send this? I can remember them throwing the trash, trying to get in the trash cans. I can remember the shaving cream lesson, my push-up lesson. I can remember my Frisbee lesson. Those moments stick in my head. But if I had just taught my basic lessons with nothing special to them, nothing would really stand out for me in the spring. It would kind of just blur together. And if you're teaching the same lessons year after year, you're gonna get in a cycle. You're just gonna die quicker. You're gonna roll on out. You gotta put divots and excitement and passion into every day that you can, because when you do, not only will you be happier as an educator, but your students will learn more, they'll wanna be in your classroom. That's why we teach y'all. If you're gonna be here, be here. If you're gonna do it, do it. Go into that classroom and give it all you got. And on those days though, when you ain't got time to plan nothing special, and you don't want to do no throw trash can in the trash thing because you're in a bad mood and you just don't feel like doing it. On those days, you got to fake it. Be an actor, smile at those kids, and give them love and energy. Because when you do that, they're going to be attracted to you and they're going to want to be in your classroom. So everyone, I hope you have the most amazing, wonderful rest of the year. I want to thank the Meemic Foundation for sponsoring this special day, for uplifting us, and for reminding us people do care about us. People do respect teachers. People love us for what we do and the impact we make on the lives of kids. And I love you too. You're all special. I wish you the best of luck for the rest of the year and do whatever it takes to make a difference in the life of every child. Thank you all.
What an inspirational evening. Did you feel the love too? I want to thank all of our speakers tonight. They were absolutely wonderful. So for all that you do to educate our children, all of us at the Meemic Foundation want to say thank you. Wishing you all the very best for a great, great school year.